If you're going through IVF or you're planning to do IVF, you've probably heard about assisted hatching. It's a technique used in the IVF lab. But what is assisted hatching? Does it really help you get pregnant? How does it work? Today, we're going to go through the science and the evidence, and you're going to learn all about assisted hatching. I'm Dr. Laura Shaheen. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist helping people with IVF and assisted hatching for over 20 years. And I love educating. If this is your first time finding the channel, welcome. I am so glad that you're here. Be sure and subscribe so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And if you're coming back, you've already subscribed. Thank you. I am so glad that you're here. And I'm glad you're finding this information and education valuable. There's two other ways to connect with me and get lots of information. Number one is my weekly newsletter. I have a link in the description below. You get weekly updates on educational content and recommendations that I have. The other way is my weekly podcast. I love teaching, interviewing people in the fertility space and community. Look for my podcast. Here's a playlist on YouTube, as well as you can listen anywhere, Apple, Spotify, anywhere you listen to podcasts. But today we are going to learn all about assisted hatching. We're going to go over four main topics. Number one, we're going to review exactly what assisted hatching is. Number two, we're going to go through why assisted hatching is often used in the IVF lab. Number three, we're going to go over what the embryologist is doing in the lab when they do assisted hatching. And number four, we're going to go through who should consider using assisted hatching. We will review the evidence. Now, stick around to the end of the video where I will give you three important questions to ask your doctor about your personal situation and whether you should do assisted hatching or not. Topic number one, what is assisted hatching? Assisted hatching is a way to help the embryo do a process that it normally does in order to implant into the uterine lining and help you conceive. So the embryo is surrounded by a shell. It's a structure called the zona pellucida. And the embryo, the cells inside of that shell or that zona pellucida, need to hatch out of the shell in order to attach to and implant into the uterine lining. So this step is really important for conception and getting pregnant and success with your IVF cycle. And assisting this process or assisting the hatching can be done in the IVF lab to hopefully help in this process. Number two, why is assisted hatching important, or why is this process even considered? Well, you know how important it is for an embryo to implant into the uterine lining, and it's got to break out of this zona pellucida and implant. And embryos will often do this on their own. That's what happens without IVF, or sometimes people will transfer an embryo into the uterine cavity without helping in that process. But assisted hatching is actually thinning the shell or thinning the zona pellucida with a couple of different types of techniques in order to allow the embryo to come out of that shell. And it hopefully helps people conceive if hatching might be one of the reasons that somebody is not getting pregnant. So assisted hatching is a technique used in the IVF lab to help a process that needs to happen anyway along the conception journey. Number three, how does assisted hatching work? Well, when the embryologist is looking at the embryo under the microscope and he sees the zona pellucida, there are three different techniques that you can thin the shell or the zona pellucida around the embryo to allow the hatching process to occur. Number one, there's laser assisted hatching, where a little laser is used to pulse energy on the zona pellucida, and it allows a little weakness or an opening in the wall to assist in hatching. Technique number two is chemical assisted hatching, where there's an acidic solution that is placed next to the zona pellucida and it thins that layer. And number three, there's mechanical assisted hatching, where a needle is used very gently to thin an area in the zona pellucida to, again, allow the embryo to come out. Each method is done very carefully under a microscope with a trained embryologist. Topic number four, who should consider assisted hatching? Like, should everyone who's doing IVF use assisted hatching, or only in certain situations? Let's talk about it. There are pros and cons to any medical intervention, and IVF is a lot of choices, a lot of different things that can happen. For example, I have a video here on the different ways that you can fertilize eggs and sperm once they're in the lab, and I talk about whether it should be conventional insemination insemination, or ICSI. ICSI is a process of actually placing a sperm into each egg. That's a really important thing to discuss with your doctor. Another choice you need to make when you're doing IVF is whether or not to do genetic screening on the embryos. So you should understand that process of biopsying cells away from the embryo and testing them for chromosomes or certain genetic mutations. And I have a whole video here on that. This video is talking about another process that can happen in the IVF lab called assisted hatching. And there's a wonderful review article and practice guidelines from the American Society of Reproductive Medicine, which is the medical kind of group that reviews evidence for reproductive endocrinologists and reproductive urologists and embryologists, a lot of people in the fertility world, to help kind of combine a lot of the evidence, interpret it, and give guidelines in the field. So this is a really, really helpful practice guideline, and I will make sure you have the reference for it, and I'll be talking a lot about the studies that are in that practice guideline. So the theory behind the benefit of assisted hatching is that maybe one of the reasons people are not getting pregnant is that this is a process that's not happening naturally in their body. And so if the embryo can't hatch out of the zona and it can't, then it can't attach, it can't implant. So by assisting in this thinning of the shell and allowing the embryo to come out, people feel like it should increase the chances of success and pregnancy with an embryo transfer. Risks that have been discussed with assisted hatching are risks to the embryo. You know, any intervention, there might be risks as you're manipulating the embryo. And another risk is an increase of monozygotic twinning. So there's different types of twinning. I've got a great video here that kind of goes through the different types of twinning. But if you have one embryo that splits into two, like after the transfer, that's how you can get twins even with a single embryo transfer. And they're monozygotic, meaning it's the same genes, it's identical twins. And some people theorize that there might be an increased risk of monozygotic twinning with assisted hatching. We'll go over the evidence in just a minute. Now, there's one instance where assisted hatching is required, and that is when you are doing chromosomal screening, genetic screening, or biopsying of the embryos. So in order to allow the biopsying the embryos to be safe, as the embryos are growing a little bit earlier in the process, the assisted hatching will occur. And then a couple of days later, the embryo is starting to kind of come out. It makes it easier for the embryologist to biopsy some of the cells safely and leave the rest of the embryo nice and safe and intact before freezing. So if you're doing pre-implantation genetic testing of embryos for aneuploidy or for genetic mutations, if you're biopsying the embryo, then assisted hatching is a part of that process. The question remains, if you are not doing PGTA or biopsying an embryo, should you do assisted hatching or not? Now, in this excellent review from ASRM, they talk about early studies that showed that assisted hatching improved pregnancy rates. So in one early randomized control trial published in 1990 with 72 patients, assisted hatching in certain patients showed increased implantation rates. And these patients included patients with, number one, thickened zona pellucida, number two, low blastomere or cell number, number three, increased fragmentation in the embryos, and number four, advanced maternal age. So in these patients, in a randomized control trial, assisted hatching improved success with IVF. Early research like this really led to general recommendations in the field that there were three patient populations that should do assisted hatching. Number one, eggs over 37 years old. Number two, visually thick zona pellucidas. And number three, patients with failed IVF cycles before or failed implantation before. This ASRM guideline goes on to really divide the research into two specific questions. Again, these are patients who are not doing genetic screening or biopsying of their embryos. Should they do assisted hatching? And first they looked at patients that were doing fresh embryo transfers, and then they looked at patients that are doing frozen embryo transfers, because maybe the recommendations would be different. So first question to answer, if you're not doing genetic screening on your embryos and you're doing a fresh embryo transfer, should you do assisted hatching? Well, the studies and the results are mixed. In one high-quality randomized control trial of about 200 patients that were randomized doing fresh embryo transfers, assisted hatching or not assisted hatching, there really was not a difference in success rates. The patients included in this study had these criteria: less than 39 years old, first or second IVF cycle with no more than one prior failed cycle, a diagnosis of unexplained infertility, endometriosis or male factor or tubal factor infertility and good quality cleavage stage or day three embryos. So again, in these kind of good prognosis patients, assisted hatching for a fresh embryo transfer in this randomized controlled trial did not show a difference in outcomes. Another great study that ASRM shows is a meta-analysis looking at over 20 different studies trying to evaluate the use of assisted hatching in fresh embryo transfers. And overall, if you look at all the studies and try to combine the data to get a big number and kind of a powerful recommendation, overall, assisted hatching was shown to improve implantation rates. However, when they separated out the studies into certain criteria and certain groups of patients, they did not see a difference in outcomes. For example, if they only looked at the 18 studies that were using laser-assisted assisted hatching, they did not see a difference in pregnancy rates. And if you only included the 5 studies that included live birth as an outcome, they did not see a difference in live birth with assisted hatching. And if you only looked at the 21 studies that included good prognosis patients, again, assisted hatching did not seem to improve the success rates with a fresh embryo transfer. So in summary, some studies showed an improvement in success rates with assisted hatching and a fresh embryo transfer, but not all of the studies did, especially if the patients had good prognosis. This is why a personal recommendation from your doctor and looking at your specific clinical indication and outcome is really important to do. Now, what about frozen embryo transfers? So ASRM looked at this separately. The thought is that if the embryos have been frozen, that maybe the zona pellucida is going to be a little bit tougher, a little bit thicker, and maybe assisted hatching is really important for frozen embryo transfers. Let's see what the evidence showed. These studies have mixed results too. There are multiple studies, randomized controlled trials, you try to combine all this information and look with meta-analysis. And really, overall, there's not a strong recommendation to routinely recommend assisted hatching just because someone's doing a frozen embryo transfer. So assisted hatching is an option when you're doing IVF. And there are some studies that show that it's helpful in certain situations. And other studies show it's not harmful, but it also might not be as helpful as we assume, that maybe those embryos know how to hatch out of that zona pellucida just fine on their own. Now, back to the risk of twins. So multiple studies have looked at this. It's more theoretical that assisted hatching will increase the risk of monozygotic twins. But if you look overall, ASRM guidelines say that it's not consistently that monozygotic twinning would be increased with assisted hatching. So assisted hatching, lots of studies, common practice in IVF. There are definitely indications for it, but it is something to really speak to your doctor about your personal situation. Now, I'm glad that you stuck around to the end of this video because I do want to give you 3 specific questions to ask your doctor about whether you should do assisted hatching or not in your IVF cycle. Question number 1, do I need assisted hatching based on my age, based on my diagnosis, based on your recommendation for my personal situation? Do I need assisted hatching? Question number 2, what method does your embryology use to do assisted hatching? I think it's important to understand exactly what's happening with your embryos. And in that question, also ask about the risks. You know, with this particular methodology, are there any risks in doing assisted hatching? And the 3rd question is, how does assisted hatching impact success rates in your IVF lab? So this is important because every lab is a little bit different. Labs track their data, they track their outcomes. And so it's important not only to understand assisted hatching with your personal situation and your clinical information, but also the lab that you're using, what do they see? And what are the success rates that they see with assisted hatching? I hope these questions are helpful. I hope you learned a lot from this video. It is so important to understand all the different things that are happening in IVF. Assisted hatching is just one piece of the puzzle, but I hope that this will empower you to understand your situation more and have a thorough conversation with your doctor about what is right for you. Like this video if you found it valuable. Share it with a friend that's undergoing IVF and they might want to learn more about assisted hatching. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get your weekly video all about reproductive health. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.